The Humana Honor Medicare Advantage Plan gives you $1,680 back each year in your Social Security check. Choose coverage that helps you keep more money in your pocket. Learn more at GetHumana.com. Humana, a more human way to healthcare. The Part B Give Back benefit pays part or all of your Part B premium, and the amount may change based on the amount you pay for Part B. Limitations and restrictions may apply. Humana is a Medicare Advantage HMO and PPO organization with a Medicare contract. Enrollment in any Humana plan depends on contract renewal.
Wake up with the news and information you can trust. Starting your day the right way with the Andy Griffin Show. This is News Radio 890, 92.5 KDXU.
Hey, good morning to you. It's 908 on KDXU. I'm Andy. Thanks for tuning into the program. Stockton is here with me today as well. Hi, Stockton.
Hello.
Thanks for hanging out with me, man.
Of course.
Hanging out and being cool. Bruno Mars's birthday. I know a lot of our listening audience is like, yeah, I'm not sure, really sure who that is, but Bruno Mars was to Stockton's generation what Hall & Oates or Madonna was to my generation. A person with a long string of hits, and they were played so much that we got sick of them.
Yes, and so. They are still played. I mean, our sister station at Star 98, I hear a Bruno Mars, at least two Bruno Mars songs over the course of the morning show. So it's still overplayed.
you're probably finding this now, like I am with, say, Hall & Oates, or a band, or even Michael Jackson. Was so sick of them at the time of their popularity, at the height of their popularity, that I actually didn't want to ever hear them again. And then 10, 15, 20, now, 40 years later, it's kind of cool to hear them again.
Oh, absolutely. You know? Well, and Bruno Mars has kind of gotten that way with me, but I also tend not to listen to variety stations too much. That's not to say that Star 98 isn't great. I know we love Dave, and he is great on Star 98.
Yeah,
John and Dave. There are some songs from Bruno Mars I don't think I'll ever like hearing, specifically Happy.
See, I'm not actually familiar with that one as much as some of the others. So.
That's the clap along if you feel if happiness is the truth.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
And the whole time you just hear happy, happy, happy,
okay,
happy.
Okay, yeah, all right, yeah, all right.
And it's just, oh my gosh. I mean, I said it earlier, but in concert choir, they made us sing Happy because it had just come out, and there was a website. I don't think it's around anymore. I might be wrong about that, but it's happy247.com. What it is it was a big campaign put together by Bruno Mars, where you could see Happy, people dancing to Happy all around the world at all times
of
the day.
At any time, yeah.
Yeah. And it was like music video quality, which was cool, but it's just a repeat of the song over and over and over and over again, and people just dancing to it. So, yeah, it gets annoying.
I wanted to talk a little bit about a couple of headlines in the news today. I want to talk about that garbage truck that crashed yesterday. But
yeah.
A couple of things I wanted to mention coming up on the calendar. On October 26th, they're opening a new, it's called the Signature Pickle Club. It's out off Washington Dam Road. So maybe, you live in Santa Clara, Ivan, you're probably going to not make that drive over there. But if you live on the east side of town, it's actually fairly convenient to folks who live in Hurricane and in Washington. And they are opening on October the 26th, which is, what is that, two Saturdays from now or something like that?
I believe so, yeah.
And so that's going to be kind of cool. I'll be there much of the morning and part of the afternoon as well. They'll be giving away membership raffles. They'll have free food and all kinds of very cool stuff at this Signature Pickle Club. Happening the same day, and this is why I'm not going to be there all day, is also the Southern Utah Blues Festival out at Tuacon. Now, I am... as an old sax player, I was exposed to a lot of music, blues, jazz, of course, pop. And I just kind of developed this little soft spot in my heart for jazz and blues. And I love blues music. And it's the kind of music that makes you feel good to feel bad.
Oh, yeah.
If there is such a thing. And so I am planning on heading out to the Blues Festival. And again, they're not a paid sponsor or anything. I just love that kind of music. And I'm going to go out there. They have a lineup of bands for the Blues Festival that are, you know, I mean, these, some of them are, I mean, we're talking about national bands. We're talking about big bands.
Yeah.
From all over the country. So, and that's on October 26th as well. So I think I'm going to do Signature Pickle Club in the morning and then go over to the Blues Festival in the afternoon. And then if I have any energy left whatsoever, okay, I won't. What am I saying?
You certainly like to have your Saturdays packed, don't you?
They are. Yeah, this last Saturday, we did the St. George Marathon in the morning, and I did not do the marathon. I broadcast the marathon. I don't want to make, I don't want to deceive anybody into thinking that I could actually run 26 miles. I could not.
You just sit, right out the side of the finish line.
But I did talk for a marathon, 2.5 hours of talking. So yes, it's kind of like a marathon.
But then you went on to judge a car show.
Yeah, there was a funeral and then a car show. The revved up for Rotary car show in the afternoon. And then a buddy of mine had his retirement party on Saturday night as well.
So, jeez, man.
And he coincidentally drove for Allied Waste. And we had a story in the news this morning about a garbage truck. Maybe if you can just give us the nuts and bolts of what happened.
Okay, so Friday morning, about 6:10 a.m., Santa Clara Ivins authorities essentially responded to a garbage truck that had rolled off the side of the road onto its side through a bike path. It was on Tuacon Drive. And fortunately, no one was seriously injured. But it turned out, reportedly, the driver fell asleep at the wheel, and that's why it veered off to the side of the road.
And this was way early in the morning, like at 6 or something, right?
6:10 a.m. is when they got the report.
You know what I was thinking about? As you were doing that story and some of the other details I read about it, I was like, you know, he went, and garbage trucks are big. These are big old trucks. He went across or through a bike path on his way to the crash.
And onto like a dirt road on the side.
And that's the time of morning where a lot of people are out walking or riding their bikes. And so very, very fortunate that nobody else was involved in this. And the driver was okay, too.
The statement also made a point to acknowledge that it did go through a bike path. And fortunately, no one was in the way.
Yeah.
So this is a very nice case of no one getting hurt. But they did have to call in what they call two heavy wreckers, is what the statement said, to get that huge, I mean, those things are ginormous.
I don't know.
Get them onto the straight and narrow.
I don't know who was driving the truck, but I have a feeling that there's going to be, he may not be driving that for them anymore. I don't know. I don't know. It's a sad deal. But, you know, falling asleep at the wheel. I was talking with a friend of mine last night. And they had shared a room with another couple who snored really badly, and they didn't get
my
any
parents.
Sleep. And so they were driving back, and it's a pretty long distance where they were driving, and she had to drive for a while because the guy had a bad back, and he just couldn't sit in the driver's seat. So she's working on zero sleep, basically, because they snored all night long, and she has to drive the last 5 hours home or something, and she said she's pretty sure there was divine intervention that got them home that day because she was so tired that she doesn't know how she kept her eyes open.
My mom had a similar experience. She used to sing in a choir in Cedar City, and we used to drive in this big old van. Me and my brother above me, he's 3 years older than me, I guess we were with my mom, and there was this really freaky experience where my mom had just barely finished in Cedar City and was driving back in this van in the dark. Essentially, she fell asleep at the wheel, and she was about to drive off of what's essentially a cliff, and the guardrail just jolted her awake, and she says it's divine intervention, and I'd be inclined to agree.
A lot of times in those instances, they wake up and overcorrect. They jerk the wheel and end up rolling, and
absolutely.
So you're right. There must have been a hand in there somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe Jesus took the wheel, perhaps, for a minute. It was reported this morning in the news that with under a month left before Election Day, early voting is kicking off today in four more states. Right now, I think they're up to like 8 or 10 states already have sent out ballots. The four states that get early voting now, Ohio, New Mexico, Indiana, and Wyoming, the rule in Utah, they mail out ballots 21 days before the election. So the election is the first week of November. You do the math backwards. You're like, yeah, mid-October. So we are getting close, probably in the next week or so.
Yeah.
And mail those ballots out.
And we tend to report on, not tend, we do. We report on when the ballots arrive. So we'll be sure to give you guys a reminder once they show up. Because heaven knows this election's a little tumultuous. So
a little bit, yeah. You know, and the thing about it, I know there are a lot of people who are like, well, we need to stop this early voting. We need to, this is, mail-in voting is... Okay, you can have your opinion about that, but the fact of the matter is them are the rules right now. This is what we live under,
yeah.
These rules. So if you want your candidate to win, and of course we're pretty partisan to Donald Trump here on KDXU, you have got to get out and get it done. Get your vote in early and say, no, I declare this is who I want. And, you know, if you wait... You're not doing anybody any favors by waiting, I don't believe.
Well, and I'll say mail-in voting absolutely has a place. My grandparents are in their 90s now, and they can't really go anywhere. So mail-in voting is the way for them to get their voices heard because they can't go to the booths. They can't stand in line for that long.
And
it's just I wish that wasn't the case. They're very sound of mind, but they're not sound of body, if that makes sense.
So you're old enough. Did you do the in-person stand in line for a long time voting when you were younger?
I did. My first election was the 2016 one, and I went and I stood in line and voted.
It was an interesting time. Excuse me. It was an interesting time. But one thing I noticed is if you're in line, say, for concert tickets or if you're in line to get food or whatever, it can be a little bit tense, you know. I mean, you're looking at someone butts in line. I'm gonna, you know. I mean,
oh yeah.
There's I noticed with the voting, everybody was happy, proud, just feeling good. Like I'm here because I'm an American and I want to make a difference. I love that about that.
Yeah.
So, all right. Real quick, I wanted to read the story off the wire this morning. A troubling story from Salt Lake area.
Yes.
The Utah Highway Patrol is investigating the deadly shooting of now listen to the ages of the people involved here. A 50-year-old man was killed. Troopers say two vehicles were traveling eastbound on SR 201 near I-215 in West Valley City yesterday. And at some point, shots were fired and one of the vehicles crashed. Police found the one man dead at the scene and took a 44-year-old man into custody. The road was closed for about 5 hours. Troopers believe it was a case of road rage and are looking into the shooting as a possible either homicide or self-defense. Now, we're not talking about an 18-year-old and a 23-year-old. We're not talking about young hotheads. We're talking about guys... Dad's probably, maybe even if you're 50, he's probably close to, if he's not already, a grandpa.
Right.
Involved in this incident. And, you know, Stockton, when I first read the story, without seeing the ages, when I just first heard about it.
You assumed it was someone around my age.
Yeah, a couple of young guys being idiots, because I was a young guy and I was an idiot.
Yeah.
But instead, these are guys close to my age, and that just blows my mind, man.
Well, and I've honestly thought that was the case too, where it was just like, oh, all the dumb traffic accidents are always people my age because they're just young and stupid or whatever.
Yeah.
But I found ever since I got this job that there's not really a bias here. This just people can be, regardless of age, can be stupid. but they can also be smart. So,
over the years, I've had a couple of, I wouldn't call them road rage incidents, but incidents where, you know, somebody got mad at me or I got mad at somebody and it was weird. You might shake your fist at them. Some people flip the bird. I don't do that, but some people do that. You might give them the stink eye at the next stoplight or whatever, but I never in my life have ever thought any of these incidents warranted any kind of physical confrontation. I remember one time, and I've told this story before here on the air, but I remember one time we lived on Main Street in Logan, this little girl was riding her bike kind of out in the middle of the street, and it's a relatively busy road, and so we were pulling up to our house, so we lived right there on Main Street, and I think it's Center Street, actually, not Main. Main is the big giant one. Center is the crossroad. Anyway, So as I stopped, I mentioned to the girl, hey, little girl, you know, she's probably 7 years old, maybe. I said, you need to ride on the side of the road. You can't ride in the middle of the road. You're going to get hurt.
Yeah.
Well, her dad was right there, like two houses away.
And he took offense to that.
And, boy, he came over to my, and I was still in my car. I wasn't out yet. He came over to my car, and he started hollering, how dare you say anything to my daughter? Who do you think you're? You know, he was going on and on and on. Now, I'm a large man. So when I got out of the car at 6'5" and 300 pounds, I got out of the car. He saw how big I was. Oh, he backed off quite a bit. He backpedaled quite a bit, as a matter of fact. But still, I was, you know, instead of being upset at his daughter for riding in the middle of the street when a car was coming, or instead of at least asking me, because he wasn't privy to what I had said to the girl. He just saw that I had said something to his daughter. So instead of inquiring as to what I might have said, and I had my wife with me, there was, you know, we were together, he just immediately assumed the worst and started screaming at me. And I thought, what have we come to as a society when, first of all, our kid can do no wrong, and second of all, we assume the worst about everyone. And maybe he was assuming, oh, this guy's a child molester. What, I don't know what he was saying, what he was assuming. But I just know that instead of trying to find out what really happened, he just immediately jumped to this conclusion and started freaking out.
Yeah.
So I don't know. This road rage thing up in the Salt Lake area, it bothers me a lot. Especially, like I said, finding out that these are guys that are my age. What's going on? What is happening here?
Yeah, yeah.
Anyway.
You got let the peer, let the influence of your peers just glance off your shoulders.
I guess so. By the way, later on in the program, in about 20 minutes or so, we're going to hear from Macrae Heppler. Macrae is down, his latest video is about Mall Drive there on the east side and some of the things that are happening over there. He also officially, and it was unofficial for like 6 months, but officially Winco has been approved to go in across from Brio there on Buena Vista in Washington City. So we're going to have a Winco here in southern Utah. He has a little video. He actually had Chris Staley on, the mayor of Washington City, talking about that. So we'll talk a little bit about Winco and about Mall Drive and some of the stuff that's happening out there. You know, kind of down Mall Drive past Smith's, down by Lynn's and all that. So there's a whole bunch of new stuff going in there.
Yeah.
As well. So we're going to hear from Macrae in just a little while. All right. Stockton, I want to ask you a question.
Okay.
All right. And I'll preface it by saying my friend went to San Francisco, and in San Francisco they have driverless cars.
Yes,
they have
driverless taxis
with no driver. You get in. He said it was really. He said two things. First of all, it was really cool.
Yeah.
And they actually have it. So there's not like a robot there or anything. There's nobody in the. They have a driver's seat. There's nobody in it.
Yeah.
He said it was really cool, but he said it was also a little bit scary.
Of course it would be.
Because
you'd be crazy to not be scared of it.
So I'm asking you, would you get in a driverless car and go driving around a busy city in it?
Actually, yeah.
You would?
Okay. Yeah. Well, I would love to try it because it's one of those things that, I mean, we have Kim Commando, influence all over our station.
And she said absolutely she would not.
But she also said that driverless cars are in the future. Mm-hmm. It's just she doesn't think it should be right now.
Not ready yet.
And so I'm kind of the same mindset. I think that they've been rushing so hard to put it out there. And I'm just like, no, I think we should be waiting a little more. Because I think with artificial intelligence becoming more and more advanced, I think that's the future of driverless cars, is actually having artificial intelligence running your car. But
So I thought this was really interesting. My friend got in this driverless car. They're driving up a very crowded, very busy city road. Mm-hmm. And a car, you know how if you want to parallel park, you stop in front of where you're going to parallel park and then you back into it?
Yeah, you go mirror, you line up the rearview mirrors and then you get a little to the twice to the left.
So he comes up in his driverless taxi and it pulls right behind the guy that's going to back into a spot.
Ah.
And he said, oh, I've detected one of the flaws of a driverless taxi.
It can't tell if it's just stopping or if it's parallel parking.
This was really cool. He said the driverless taxi actually threw it in reverse. backed up so that it was behind where that spot was.
Oh.
And then stopped and waited for the guy to back to parallel park in the spot. He said he was actually really impressed that the driverless taxi actually did that.
So, I mean, it's cool. You got to admit, it's cool.
That's cool.
But also, yeah, it's just you, there's something about getting in a giant hunk of metal.
3,600 pounds.
Yeah, and you're getting a giant hunk of metal and nobody's behind the wheel that you can, like, influence. You know what I mean? It's just you leave it to the tech and hope nothing glitches out. But then you can also argue, like, don't normal people do that anyway?
Yeah. And you know what? I can think of a handful of people that I would rather be in a driverless car than,
yeah, exactly,
than ride with them.
It's just, it's such a foreign concept to us that it's just, I could see it happening, being way more accepted like 10 years down the line. Right now, it's just with all like the distrust of artificial intelligence and all the guidelines we want to set and all that stuff. It's just, it's all wacky.
So years ago, my father-in-law, bless his heart, doesn't drive anymore. He's got dementia and he's really struggling right now with some mental things. And he's mid-80s and, you know, like I said, bless his heart. We wish him the best, but the prognosis does not look good. But years ago, we used to, you know, you go out. This was before we had kids. We'd go out with my wife's parents and dad would drive. And he was a scary driver back then. And he was, we think he had a depth perception problem because he would come up to an intersection. The light is red. There's cars stopped, not moving at the intersection. And he would be accelerating as he got closer and closer. Ugh. And my wife and I in the back seat, we're like, you know, white knuckle holding each other's hands and going, you know, little Thelma and Louise, are we going to die now? Is there a cliff? I don't know. And then he would slam on the brakes at the last minute and not hit anything. And as far as I know, he never actually got into a crash, but he sure made it an experience. And there was one occasion where our son, AJ, was probably in his mid-20s, a little younger than you, but he needed a ride home. And we were going different locations. And so he got in with my father-in-law and my mother-in-law, and my wife and I in a different car made our way to where we were going. But during the course of this ride, we got a running play-by-play from my son on what it was like riding in the back seat with my father-in-law. And I don't know if I still have that somewhere in my history, but because it's been a few years now, it's been like 8 years, but it was so funny. I mean, the times that he, during this texting play-by-play, that he thought he was going to die, was sure this was the end for him. Yeah. It was funny. And they made it there alive, and he didn't get in a crash or anything. But AJ said when he got out, he said, I will never, ever ride with them again. Never.
Oh. So.
It's 9:30 on KDXU. Let's do a weather check. Like I said, we're about 15 minutes away from Macrae Heppler joining us here on the air. This is the Andy Griffin Show. We'll be right back.
Wake up with the news and information you can trust. This is the Andy Griffin Show on News Radio 890, 92.5 KDXU, Southern Utah's news talk leader.
Going way back in time, this is Bobby Vinton. Listen to this for just a second.
Lonely, I'm Mr. Lonely. I have nobody for my...
All right, I'm not trying to depress anybody, but Bobby Vinton once sang a very popular song called Mr. Lonely. And loneliness seems to be a thing. In fact, being alone, it's weird. So you can point back to COVID, right, where we're supposed to shelter in place, isolate at home, whatever it was, Stockton. But
right.
I found an article online by Emma Issa is her name, and she wrote about how actually Americans were getting more and more, Americans were getting more and more isolated before COVID COVID-19. Here's a couple of numbers for you. The share of eating and drinking time spent at home rose 3 percentage points from 2003 to 2019. And then, of course, it went up way up in 2022. The share of time socializing and taking part in leisure activity at home alone increased 2 percentage points from 03 to 19. And the share of time participating in religious activities at home alone, like praying or whatever, went up 17 percentage points from 2003 to 2019. We were trending toward being home alone anyway. And then 2020 and COVID kind of gave it a little punch in the ribs, like to, a little motivational, yeah, be home alone. Why do you think, Stockton, people want to be alone? You live alone.
I do.
Do you like being alone? Do you play your games alone? And I mean, you have birds, so you're not completely alone.
Well, and here's the thing about it. I hate having roommates. That's honestly just that's the biggest crux of the argument. I've been married and I've also had, several roommates at once, and I like being completely in control of my homestead.
Is it about control then, maybe? A little bit?
Not so much control. It's just, I want to be able to keep things clean, and I want to be able to keep things under, well, I think you're right. There is a sense of control, because the more I was thinking about it, I was like, the ability to just limit what is used in my home.
Yeah.
And it's just, I don't know. And overall, I just don't like interacting with people too much.
People suck. No, I'm just kidding. They don't. I like
people. I have a very specific group of friends, and they keep me from being lonely because I interact with them all the time. But it's not to the point where they're using my dishes, and the sink is always full and it's always disgusting. There's shoes in front of the doorway. There's, you know what I mean? And I got plenty of messes to worry about, for Pete's sake. You just said I have birds. In fact, I had to clean out the cage yesterday, and it was quite the, yeah.
All right. I have some more loneliness numbers
okay,
for you.
Go for
all
it.
Right. More than 60% of U.S. adults indicate that they experience feelings of loneliness. Young adults, especially aged 18 to 22, are identified as the most isolated age bracket. The percentage of individuals by themselves has risen by more than 30% in recent decades. Being socially isolated is as detrimental percentage-wise to one's health as consuming 15 cigarettes a day.
Wow.
And loneliness can elevate the likelihood of early death by as much as 50%. So lonely is not good.
No, it's not.
Now, being alone and being lonely are not the same thing.
Exactly. I don't think I'm not lonely.
You can be alone and not be lonely.
Yeah.
But the odds of you being lonely if you're alone are higher, of course.
Yes, of course.
Than if you're by. So my son loves to play, and you, I think you do too, right? The online games where you play your game on your console, but there are other people in other parts of the country or the world that you're playing with.
Of course.
Yeah. I do not like that. And here's the reason why. In the infancy of online gaming, I was pretty good at a couple of sports video games. One was Madden, whatever iteration it was at the time, Madden 12, but anyway. And the other one was an NBA game. And I can't remember if it was NBA Live or NBA 2, but whatever it was. And I was pretty good at these games. And I would go, and I wasn't like heavy into the online gaming, so I didn't have a national ranking or anything like that. But three different separate occasions, I played someone who had a very high national ranking. Mm-hmm. And on all three occasions, I was beating them soundly. And on all three occasions, their connection, quote unquote, timed out.
The good old rage quit.
So that their losing to an unranked player wouldn't go on their records.
Exactly.
And it gave me, to be quite honest, it gave me a real bitter taste in my mouth about online gaming. I'm like, look, if I go and I'm good at something, and I'm playing someone else, and we're having a good time, and it was close, but I'm winning or whatever, and they're just going to quit, then why would I even want to play? What's the point of even playing?
Fortunately, things have changed since then. If people do that, they tend to get punished.
I hope so.
They should. They get punished. They get banned, whether it's for 24 hours or longer, or they actually lose like their ranking, like they'll get demoted in their ranking, even more than if they were to just lose. So it has gotten better, but also the games I play that are like online is not competitive. It's more cooperative.
So it makes a difference.
Yeah. I'm a pirate on the high seas with my friends, delivering cargo and
Sea of Thieves, right?
Exactly. Yeah, yeah. Delivering cargo, uncovering buried treasure, fighting skeletons in a fort or whatever.
Another experience I had with Sea of Thieves, by the way, I tried to play online one time on Sea of Thieves, and I got on a ship, and you're basically playing a pirate, a part of a team, you know, whatever.
A very goofy pirate.
And, yeah. And I got somebody that was on the ship was like, "Will you please get out? This is for our friends." And I'm like, but it's open play. They're like, "No, our friend is, you need to leave." And I was like, okay.
Yeah, that's their fault. There's an actual setting that lets you set a password, for Pete's sake. Mm-hmm. So
yeah, this one was an open one.
Yeah.
So anyway, back to the loneliness factor. I had a couple of quick words of advice for people who experience loneliness. Number one, make a conscious effort to participate in social interactions. In other words, just talk to people. When you're out and about, at the store, wherever, talk to people. You'll find, I think, that people are actually more than happy to respond back. Unless they're really busy doing something, most people will sit and chat with you.
Absolutely.
Number two, focus on self-care from a this is a quoting a Positive Psychology magazine. From a therapeutic approach, reducing feelings of loneliness involves fostering a sense of connectedness as well as modifying perceptions of social isolation. In other words, I hate to put it this way, but take a bath. Do your hair. Don't wear dumpy clothes.
Hygienic.
Yeah, just feel better about yourself, and you'll be more likely to interact with other people if you're not. Yeah. You know.
There's a reason why we want to feel hygienic. It isn't just to smell good. It's also to feel good.
Yeah. All right. Number three, adopt a pet. We had a veterinarian on earlier today, and I think there's people will now know there's a major significant link to happiness and owning a pet. So I think Macrae is calling, so we'll get Macrae connected. Two more, stay virtually connected. In other words, don't be afraid of technology. You know, if your thing is going on Facebook and putting up pictures of your grandkids or just, you know, reconnecting with someone you went to high school with or whatever, go for it. Nothing wrong with that. And number five, try new experiences. And that brings up, there's a program at the university here in town. Called ICL, Institute of Continued Learning, for $90, $90. You can take as many classes as you want. Some of them are during the morning, some are in the afternoon, some are in the evening if you're still working. But these are specifically geared for people who just want to learn about stuff. And it could be, you know, Gary Sorensen of Morse Compass Travel teaches a travel class. There's classes on, you know, knitting, classes on pickleball. I mean, history, whatever it may be that you would like to learn more about, they've got them there at the Institute of Continued Learning over there at the university. Check them out. Just go to utahtech.edu, and then there's a tab there. You can just find it, Institute of Continued Learning. It's a pretty cool deal. Don't be afraid to try a few new experiences. All right, Macrae Heppler coming up when we come back. Welcome back, 9:47 on KDXU. Macrae Heppler is with me via the telephone this morning. Hi, Macrae. How are you?
Hey, doing good, Andy. How about you?
I'm doing great. Now, the big news last week or so, 2 weeks ago, WinCo is officially approved by the Washington City Council. That means it's happening, right?
It's happening.
Now, tell us a location and timeline for WinCo.
Yeah, so it is going to be just north of the new Main Street exit 12, which is right there in the middle of Washington, on the corner of Main Street and Buena Vista Boulevard. It's about a 25-acre project in total. So it's going to be a WinCo along with a bunch of other stores along with it.
Oh.
They've got plans on both sides of that Boilers pickleball complex and park right there. And so the first one is WinCo, and then they'll start working on some other other tenants right around there as well. I think the plan is about 12 to 18 months before the Winco is open.
Okay.
And so the, yeah, total project's actually 25 acres. It's going to be really cool right there. There's a lot of land, a lot more land than it might seem right there. Initially, when I heard it was going there, I was like, oh man, it doesn't seem like there's much land right there. But then you go over there and there's a lot. So it's going to be a great spot right there in Washington.
Yeah, it's bigger than it looks. For those of you wondering, so you know where the Boilers Park is, Buena Vista, Brio's across the street. It's between the Boilers and the what is Main Street. It is Exit 12. By the way, it's worth mentioning, and I know you mentioned this on your video, it's actually, we all thought it was going to be Exit 11, but it's actually Exit 12.
Yeah, so did I.
Yeah.
So did I. I even filmed it as Exit 11 because I thought that the whole time, and I guess the engineers wanted to pull a fast one on everybody and decided to make it exit 12. So,
So you got 13 Washington Parkway, 12 it would be Washington Main Street, and that's where Winco is going to be. And boy, if they get it done in 12 months, they say 12 to 18 months. Usually those lean toward the longer time as far as actually being open. But we're talking about maybe sometime late in 2025 or early 2026. That's pretty quick.
Yeah, my initial thought is probably 2026 for sure.
Now,
they're gonna move on it though for sure.
Let's go down Mall Drive now and head east out to 3000 East, and they call it Washington Fields out there for a reason. There was used to be nothing but kind of fields, and they were raising crops and animals and stuff like that. But the fields are turning into something different now, aren't they?
They are. Yeah, finally getting some commercial out there so we don't all have to drive into town for everything.
Tell us a little bit about what you learned about what's going in and what's going on out there in Washington Fields.
Yeah, so right around the Lens, that's just on the corner of 3000 and Mall Drive, something happened on really every corner there. The first one is the brand new news as well, just east of the Lens is a commercial development called the Paseo, and it's got all kinds of shopping and dining with a big entertainment anchor. That one just got approved through St. George City Council 2 weeks ago, and don't have a lot of details on that one just yet, other than I've seen the brochure, I've seen kind of what the look is, and it's being done by a group that's put together quite a few of these around the Western United States. And I'm really excited for it. It looks really nice, really outdoorsy, some indoor-outdoor dining and different things, bringing in some new types of restaurants and shopping. So it's going to be a cool one. And that one's just going, just like I said, in the field just east of the Lens. Right there, and I won't have anything else on that for a couple of months. But as they go through the city, but they're working on that too. So
I know that there are a lot of people that live out that way that are like, we need something. I know when Lens and Smith's were put in, they were so grateful to have grocery stores close, and now other options, I guess, are coming in, huh?
Yep. Yeah, it's gonna be awesome.
Okay. Now, you have some great, by the way, I love your video, the drone footage. You do such an amazing job. And folks, if they want to learn more, you can go to YouTube channel and search for Macrae Heppler, or I usually get him on my Facebook feed. So if you're friends with Macrae or you just search Macrae Heppler, you can watch his videos. But great drone footage of the Red Cliffs Temple. And, we found throughout, the world and certainly the United States, when a temple is built in a neighborhood, two things happen. Number one, property values go up. And number two, stuff starts to get built in the surrounding area. Are we seeing that happen with Red Cliffs Temple?
Yeah. I mean, that's where I'm so glad that you hit on that point, because oftentimes when there's a commercial development, especially when there's like shopping, there's a grocery or there's something that, a lot of times the narrative or the thought is that if something like that goes close to my house, it's going to make my property values go down because there's potentially more traffic or potentially some crime. And I've never really understood that, because in my brain, if there's a commercial development going within walking distance or within a short drive of my house, I think the convenience of that far outweighs any new traffic or new crime that happens because of that commercial development. And so a lot of times I hear concerns of like, oh, my property value is going to go down. I'm like, no, like your property value is going to go up.
Yeah.
And so I'm glad that you brought that up. And I like to have that conversation with people, because it's kind of a common thing that people think that. And, you know, as I have that conversation, it just makes sense. You know, neighborhood commercial and things that are close nearby just make things go up in value. And anyway, so I think with the temple out there, with all the residents that live out there, and there's just never been anything, there's never been commercial anywhere in Washington Fields area, and we're finally starting to get it, and it's going to be good. I'm excited.
They even have a place out there, I think it's off Sandia, Whammers, which is a convenience store. I didn't even know it was there, and my wife and I went driving one day. I guess I knew it was there, but it didn't register for me until I actually drove there, and I was like, hey, look at that. It was kind of
Whammers has been a hit. That's that, and then the Baskin-Robbins with the drive-thru is going to be open up here pretty soon.
Yeah.
And then they're working on the other spot, too, so hopefully it's some more food.
Is there anything else you can tell us about the Fields area of what might be coming or what to look for out there by Lynn's?
Yeah, I mean, there's a new event center called Astor Weddings and Events in the new the right across from where I was just talking about, in the new professional building where all the food trucks are. One, there's a bunch of food trucks there every day, which is really cool. And then two, it's a new event space that's really nice. Dixie Dental is also going in that building, and then they're working on a couple others to fill the rest of the space. And then right in front of, there's two other buildings kind of to the west and to the north of Lynn's that are just about finishing up. I don't have any confirmation of who's going in exactly, the one just north of the Lynn's, but the one to the east, it's right next to Quick Quack. There's a Starbucks going in there, as well as Marco's Pizza, which is a new concept to St. George, and I've heard really good things about. And then they've got a tanning salon and I can't remember what the other one was. They haven't given me the names of those yet. And so,
well, I can promise you the Griffins will be going to Marco's Pizza as soon as they open. we love pizzas. So.
I have heard really good things. So,
down to about 2 minutes, Macrae, I did want to leave you just a couple of minutes to talk a little bit about Black Desert. It is Black Desert PGA week here in
PGA
Southern
week.
Utah.
It is indeed. The time is here. I can't believe it's already here. It's crazy.
Now, I guess the pros are in town maybe today and tomorrow doing practice rounds and getting ready. And then the tournament is Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. And what do you think, Macrae, the effect will have on St. George's popularity when people from around the country, maybe around the world, see, you know, the drone footage of our beautiful red rocks and lava rocks, lava fields and everything? What do you think is going to happen?
Well, more people are going to come here.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, a lot more.
For me, I'm always going to advocate for that. I would rather be in a thriving economy, a thriving town with a lot of good momentum going forward, than the opposite. And I realize that, you know, sometimes there's inconveniences when people are here. Like this whole month is going to be, you know, we had the marathon last weekend. We've got the PGA this week. We've got Huntsman World Senior Games starting. We've got the Red Bull Rampage out in Virgin, which is a world-class biking event. We've got, we have
Fall Brawl Pickleball.
Trail Hero. We've got the Fall Brawl Pickleball. I mean, there's so much happening. And for me, I absolutely love it because, yes, there's going to be convenience. There's going to be some inconveniences. There's going to be more traffic. There's going to be more wait times at restaurants and different things. But I can promise you that the impact on our small local businesses, especially the restaurants, the shops, the people that really depend on tourism, they are getting fed And I love it because I know where they're at during the slow times, like the summer, where people don't come here as often and they struggle. And so I love these events. I advocate for these events. And I think that it's so worth some of the inconveniences that we sometimes have because of them.
A lot of old timers have been here their whole lives, say, oh, I don't want us to keep growing. But Macrae, he's a St. George lifer. He loves it. And
I'm a lifer.
Yeah. Macrae, thanks for coming on today.
Yeah, thanks, Andy.
We'll wrap it from here. Macrae Heppler on the Andy Griffin Show. See you later, Macrae.
Okay, thanks. See you, Andy.
9:59 on KDX. We've got to turn it over to national news, and then Clay and Buck will be on the air here on KDX. Thank you so much for listening. We'll be back tomorrow.
The Humana Honor Medicare Advantage Plan gives you $1,680 back each year in your Social Security check. Choose coverage that helps you keep more money in your pocket. Learn more at GetHumana.com. Humana, a more human way to healthcare. The Part B Give Back benefit pays part or all of your Part B premium, and the amount may change based on the amount you pay for Part B. Limitations and restrictions may apply. Humana is a Medicare Advantage HMO and PPO organization with a Medicare contract. Enrollment in any Humana plan depends on contract renewal.